Hi, I'm Carl Weber, and this is Video Aided Instructions English Grammar Series. The topic for this program is using pronouns correctly. As you recall, a pronoun is a word that takes the place of a noun or a group of nouns. The noun or group of nouns that the pronoun takes the place of is called its antecedent. Look at this sentence, for example. Angela called Khalid and invited him to go skating with her. Now, this sentence contains two pronouns, him and her, and each of these pronouns has an antecedent. The antecedent of him is Khalid, because that's the noun that the pronoun him takes the place of. The antecedent for her is Angela, because that's the noun that her takes the place of. Notice that those nouns could be substituted for the pronouns, and the sentence would still mean the same thing. Angela called Khalid and invited Khalid to go skating with Angela. The sentence would mean the same thing, but it sounds rather awkward and repetitious, which is why we use pronouns instead. But a pronoun and its antecedent should always match. There are many different kinds of pronouns: he, him, she, her, it, we, some, any, who, which, someone. All of these words are pronouns of different kinds. Now, using pronouns can be tricky. In this program, we'll review some of the rules for using pronouns. We'll also look at examples of the kinds of errors people often make when using pronouns, and we'll show you how to avoid making those same mistakes. There are many kinds of pronouns. The four that are most important are personal pronouns, interrogative pronouns, indefinite pronouns, and relative pronouns. In this lesson, we'll look at each of these four types of pronouns and see how they're used in English sentences. First, personal pronouns. A personal pronoun refers to the person speaking, the person being spoken to, or the person or thing being spoken about. Some of the most common personal pronouns are I, me, you, he, him, she, her, it, we, us, they, and them. Now, remember we said that a personal pronoun may refer to the person speaking. Personal pronouns like I, me, we, and us refer to the person speaking. A personal pronoun may refer to the person being spoken to. There's only one pronoun that plays that role, you. Or a personal pronoun may refer to the person or thing being spoken about. And some of the pronouns that can play that role are he, him, she, her, it, they, and them. Notice that pronouns can be either singular or plural. As you recall, singular means referring to one thing or one person, while plural means referring to two or more things or persons. We saw a moment ago that pronouns and their antecedents need to match. One of the important ways in which a pronoun should always match its antecedent is in number. In other words, if the antecedent is singular, the pronoun should also be singular. If the antecedent is plural, the pronoun should also be plural. Notice one curious thing about the English language. The pronoun you can be both singular and plural. That's the only pronoun in the English language that works both ways. And because of the fact that there is no differentiation between singular and plural in the pronoun you, some linguists have theorized that English language speakers have invented a series of phrases and even new words to stand in for the plural you, which doesn't really exist. So this explains why you'll sometimes hear people use expressions like you people, you guys, yous, or down south, you all. There's no way to take the word you and turn it into a plural, so people have invented their own ways of turning you into a plural. So you can be both singular or plural. Unlike the other personal pronouns, there are no different singular and plural forms for that particular pronoun. The second important category of pronouns is interrogative pronouns. Now, you might recall that an interrogative sentence is a sentence that asks a question. And you might imagine that there's a connection between that kind of sentence and an interrogative pronoun. If that's what you're thinking, you're correct. An interrogative pronoun introduces a question. And there are 5 interrogative pronouns in English: who, whom, whose, which, and what. Now, the question that the interrogative pronoun introduces may be a direct question, in which case the sentence will end with a question mark, and the question is being asked directly of you, the person that hears the sentence. Here's an example. What do you feel like having for dinner tonight? This sentence ends with a question mark. It's asking a question of you, the person who hears the sentence, and notice that it begins with the interrogative pronoun, what. On the other hand, the question may be an indirect question. Here's an example. Andre asked Mark what he wanted for dinner. Here, the question begins with the interrogative pronoun, what, just like before. But it's an indirect question. It's not being asked directly of you, the person who hears the sentence. Instead, it's being described in the sentence as something that Andre asked Mark, and therefore it's considered an indirect question. And notice that neither the sentence nor the question ends with a question mark. But the same interrogative pronoun in this case has been used, what, to introduce, in this case, an indirect question. The third category of pronouns is indefinite pronouns. An indefinite pronoun refers to an unspecified person, place, thing, or idea. As you can see when we look at some examples of indefinite pronouns, these are words that refer in a somewhat vague way to one or more people, places, things, or ideas that are not specified or named in the sentence or anywhere near it. Here are some examples of indefinite pronouns: all, anyone, anything, both, each, everybody, many, no one, some, someone. And there are many other indefinite pronouns. You can probably make up for yourself some examples of sentences using these indefinite pronouns. Here are a couple to illustrate how indefinite pronouns might be used. All are invited to tonight's dance. Now, who's invited to tonight's dance? Have some specific people been named? No. Instead, anybody and everybody that's referred to by that indefinite pronoun all of those people are invited. Here's another example. Everybody is welcome. Here, the indefinite pronoun everybody is used as the subject of the sentence. And one more example. No one should feel shy about coming. Who should feel shy about coming? Has a person been named? No, instead the indefinite pronoun no one is used to indicate who should feel shy about coming. As you can see, indefinite pronouns don't contain a specific antecedent. Instead, they refer in a more general way to one or more people, places, things, or ideas that are not described or stated specifically in the sentence. But they're very useful words as long as they're used correctly according to some of the rules and procedures we'll talk about later in this program. And the fourth and final important category of pronouns is relative pronouns. A relative pronoun is used to introduce a subordinate clause. Now, you might recall from elsewhere in this series that there are 2 kinds of clauses that you need to be aware of that go to make up any English sentence. There are independent clauses and there are subordinate clauses. An independent clause can stand alone as a sentence. A subordinate clause cannot. When a subordinate clause tries to stand alone as a sentence, the result is a sentence fragment and a grammatical error. Instead, subordinate clauses are attached to independent clauses, and the resulting combination is a correct English sentence, known as a complex sentence. A relative pronoun is used to introduce a subordinate clause. There are just 5 relative pronouns in English: who, whom, whose, which, and that. You'll notice that some of the pronouns in this list also appeared in the list of interrogative pronouns, and there is some overlap. There are certain pronouns that can be used as either interrogative pronouns or relative pronouns. It all depends on how they're used in the sentence. When these pronouns are used as relative pronouns, what they are doing is introducing subordinate clauses and relating the subordinate clause to something specific in the independent clause. That's why they're called relative pronouns, because they relate the subordinate clause that they introduce to something specific in the independent clause. Let's take a look at a couple of examples. Sean Connery was the first actor who portrayed the secret agent James Bond. Now here we have the relative pronoun who, introducing the subordinate clause, who portrayed the secret agent James Bond. Perhaps you can tell from the way that subordinate clause sounds that it can't stand alone as a sentence. It exists in the sentence to give more information about what kind of actor Sean Connery was. Sean Connery was the first actor is what the independent clause tells us, and the subordinate clause tells us exactly what kind of actor he was. He was the actor who portrayed the secret agent James Bond. So the entire subordinate clause introduced by the relative pronoun who relates back to the noun actor. Therefore, in a sense, the entire subordinate clause acts as a modifier, much like an adjective, giving more information about a specific noun in the independent clause. And that's how the subordinate clauses introduced by relative pronouns work. They work as modifiers, giving more information about a noun that appears in the independent clause. Here's another example. Dr. No was the movie that launched the James Bond film series. In this sentence, we have an independent clause, Dr. No was the movie, followed by the subordinate clause that launched the James Bond film series. The subordinate clause is introduced by the relative pronoun that, and the entire clause serves to modify or give more information about the noun movie. Dr. No was the movie. What kind of movie? The movie that launched the James Bond film series. So, once again, we have a subordinate clause which is related to a specific noun that appears in the independent clause. The entire clause is a kind of a modifier, giving more information about that noun. So, when you have a relative pronoun in a sentence, it is introducing a subordinate clause which acts as a modifier, giving more information about a noun that appears in the independent clause. So we've seen then that there are four kinds of pronouns that are commonly used in English sentences. Personal pronouns, interrogative pronouns, indefinite pronouns, and relative pronouns. In the remainder of this program, we'll talk about some of the basic rules for using these kinds of pronouns correctly in English sentences. First, turn to your study guide. We've provided there an exercise that will enable you to test and practice your understanding of these four different categories of pronouns. Try your hand at the questions, and when you're finished, come back and we'll look at the questions together. Now, in each of the sentences in this exercise, your job is to first underline each of the pronouns that appears, and then second, decide concerning each pronoun whether it's a personal pronoun, an interrogative pronoun, an indefinite pronoun, or a relative pronoun. Let's start with the first sentence. Gordon was surprised when Angela invited him to visit her in Caracas. There are two pronouns in this sentence, him and her, and both of them are personal pronouns. So that's the answer to that question. Him and her are both pronouns, and both are personal pronouns. Next sentence. Who do you think will win the Oscar for Best Supporting Actor this year? As you can see, this is an interrogative sentence, and that might be a clue to you that an interrogative pronoun appears in this sentence. And sure enough, it does. The very first word in the sentence, who, is an interrogative pronoun. Remember, an interrogative pronoun introduces a direct or indirect question, and there are just five interrogative pronouns in English: who, whom, whose, which, and what. And in this case, who is being used to introduce a direct question. There's also another pronoun in this sentence. Did you recognize it? You is also a pronoun, and it's a personal pronoun. Remember, we saw that personal pronouns may refer to the person being spoken to. And in this case, the pronoun you is being used in that way. So in this sentence, there are two pronouns. Who is an interrogative pronoun, and you is a personal pronoun. Let's look at the next sentence. If Luis wants to finish painting the garage by tomorrow, he will have to convince someone to help him. How many pronouns did you notice in this sentence? There are three altogether: he, someone, and him. All three appear in the second half of the sentence. Now, two of the pronouns are personal pronouns. he and him are both personal pronouns. The third pronoun, someone, is a different category. This is an indefinite pronoun. Notice how the indefinite pronoun, someone, refers to a person that is not specified. It doesn't say in the sentence who is going to help Luis with painting the garage. Probably Luis doesn't even know. And so an indefinite pronoun is used to indicate that the person being referred to is indefinite, unspecified, or unknown. And that's a typical use of an indefinite pronoun. Next question. The inventor Thomas Edison is the historical figure whom I admire most. In this sentence, there are two pronouns, whom and I. We'll do I, the easy one, first. That's a personal pronoun. And as we discussed earlier, a personal pronoun may refer to the person speaking. And that's who is being referred to by the personal pronoun I. What about whom? What kind of pronoun is that? Well, we've seen that whom can be used in more than one way. Whom may be used as an interrogative pronoun, can also be used as a relative pronoun. How is it being used in this case? Is it being used to introduce a question, either a direct question or an indirect question? No, it isn't. So therefore, whom is not an interrogative pronoun in this case. Instead, it's being used as a relative pronoun. It introduces the subordinate clause, whom I admire most. Remember that a clause always contains a subject and a verb. Here the subject is I, the verb is admire, and whom is the relative pronoun that introduces this subordinate clause and relates it back to the independent clause. In fact, the entire subordinate clause acts as a modifier, giving more information about the noun figure. So there are two pronouns here. Whom is a relative pronoun, and I is a personal pronoun. Next question. Joanne's grandmother asked her what she wanted to do that evening. In this sentence, there are three pronouns, her, what, and she. Two of the pronouns are personal pronouns, her and she. The third pronoun, what, is an interrogative pronoun. Remember, we saw that an interrogative pronoun can be used to introduce either a direct or an indirect question. In this case, the pronoun what is being used to introduce an indirect question. Joanne's grandmother is asking Joanne a question, namely what she wanted to do that evening, and that question is being reported to us indirectly. So the pronoun what is an interrogative pronoun because it is introducing that indirect question. In this lesson, we're going to talk about one of the more tricky aspects of using pronouns correctly, namely pronoun case. Personal pronouns always take one of three different cases. Each case reflects a different way that the pronoun can be used in a sentence. And as we'll see, depending on which case is correct in a particular sentence, the actual form of the pronoun may change. The three cases are the subjective case, the objective case, and the possessive case. Let's take a moment to look at each of these cases and explain exactly how and when they should be used in an English sentence. First, the subjective case. The subjective case is used when the pronoun is a subject or a subject complement. As you recall, the most important word in any sentence is the verb. Now, the subject of the verb is the person, place, thing, or idea that does the action of the verb. Now, when a pronoun is the subject of the verb, it should always be in the subjective case. A pronoun should also be in the subjective case when it serves as a subject complement. Now, you might recall that there are two main types of verbs, verbs of action and verbs of being. When a verb of being appears in a sentence, it is sometimes followed by a subject complement. A subject complement is a noun or pronoun that refers back to the subject of the verb and gives more information about the subject of the verb. When a pronoun is used in that way as a subject complement, it should also be in the subjective case. Now, we've mentioned before a number of the typical personal pronouns that are used. The subjective case personal pronouns are as follows: I, you, he, she, it, we, and they. All of these pronouns are personal pronouns, and all are in the subjective case. So when a personal pronoun is being used as the subject of a verb or as a subject complement, one of the personal pronouns from the list I just gave you should be used, because these are all the subjective case pronouns. Take a look at this example. We moved to the United States 3 years ago. What's the pronoun in this sentence? Well, it's the first word. The personal pronoun we is the first word in the sentence. What role does that word play in the sentence? Well, it's the subject of the verb move. The verb moved describes the action being discussed in the sentence, and we is the subject. That's the person or persons who are doing the action. Since we is the subject of the verb moved, the subjective case pronoun we is correct. Here's another example. The fastest runner on the track team is she. Now here the pronoun is the last word in the sentence, she. Again, it's a personal pronoun in the subjective case. Why? In this case, the pronoun she is acting as a subject complement. The sentence contains a verb which expresses not action, but a state of being, namely the verb is. It's explaining a state of being, and the word she acts as a subject complement because it refers back to the subject of the verb, runner. Who is the fastest runner? She. So the subject complement she gives more information about that subject, runner. It tells who the runner is, she. So following the verb of being, we have in this case a subject complement which happens to be a pronoun. And because the pronoun is playing the role of subject complement, it needs to be in the subjective case. So again, the subjective case pronoun she has been used correctly in this sentence. You might have sensed that this second sentence example that we just gave about the fastest runner sounds a little unusual, and sentences like this using a pronoun as a subject complement are fairly rare in English. Nonetheless, they do appear occasionally, and so it's good to know that rule that a pronoun used as a subject complement should be in the subjective case. The second pronoun case is the objective case. The objective case is used when a pronoun is a direct object, an indirect object, or the object of a preposition. Now you'll recall that in a sentence, a direct object receives the action of the verb. Not all verbs have direct objects. Only certain types of verbs, known as transitive verbs, may have direct objects. In a sentence where there is a transitive verb, the action flows from the subject through the verb to the direct object, which receives the action of the verb. In those sentences, if a pronoun happens to be the direct object of the verb, it should be in the objective case. Similarly, an indirect object that happens to be a pronoun should also be in the objective case. You'll recall that an indirect object tells who or what the action of the verb is being done to or for. It doesn't receive the action of the verb directly, as the direct object does, it receives it indirectly. Once again, not all sentences contain indirect objects. When an indirect object appears, it will appear between the verb and the direct object. And if the indirect object happens to be a pronoun, then it should be in the objective case. Finally, if a pronoun is being used as the object of a preposition, then it should also be in the objective case. You'll recall that prepositions are those words, usually small words, like in, of, for, about, by, with, between, after, and so on, all of which connect what follows to the rest of the sentence. Whenever you have a preposition like that, it'll be followed by a noun or a pronoun, which is known as the object of the preposition. If the object of the preposition happens to be a pronoun, it should be in the objective case. So the objective case is used in these three circumstances, when the pronoun is a direct object, an indirect object, or the object of a preposition. Now, here are the personal pronouns which are in the objective case. Me, you, him, her, it, us, and them. You'll notice that the pronouns you and it appear on the list of the subjective case pronouns and the objective case pronouns. It so happens that those two pronouns can be used either way, either as subjective or objective case pronouns. All the other personal pronouns, however, differ from subjective to objective case, and it's important to recognize the difference so that you can use them correctly. Let's look at sentences that illustrate each of the three ways an objective case pronoun might be used. First, the nominating committee selected him. It's usually good to analyze a sentence by finding the verb first. What's the verb here? Selected. Who or what did the selecting? The committee, the nominating committee specifically. So that's the subject of the verb selected. Now what about the pronoun him? What role does that word play in the sentence? It's the direct object of the verb selected. It receives the action of the selecting. Selected is a transitive verb, and the object that receives that action is him. Since this is a pronoun being used as the direct object of the verb, it should be in the objective case, as it is, him. Look at this example. Alma sang us two songs. What's the verb in this sentence? The verb is sang. What's the subject of the verb? Who or what did the singing? Alma. Now, what's the direct object of the verb? That is, what did Alma sing? She sang two songs. So songs is the direct object of the verb sang. Now, what about the pronoun us? What role, what function does us play in this sentence? In this case, us is the indirect object of the verb sang. It doesn't tell what Alma sang. It tells who Alma sang for. Remember, the indirect object explains the person, place, thing, or idea to whom or for whom the action is done. And in this case, Alma sang for us. Since us is being used as an indirect object, it should be in the objective case as it is. Us is an objective case pronoun, and it's being used correctly here as the indirect object of the verb sang. And one more sample sentence. The Melendis named their pet parakeet after me. Here we have the pronoun me. What's the subject and what's the verb in this sentence? Well, the verb is named and the subject is Melendis. The Melendis did the action described by the verb naming. Now, what's the direct object of named? The direct object is parakeet. That's who or what the Melendis named. What's the role of the pronoun me? How does that fit into the sentence? In this case, the pronoun me is the object of the preposition after. We have a prepositional phrase in this sentence, after me. After is the preposition, me is the object of the preposition. And because the pronoun is being used as the object of a preposition, it should be in the objective case as it is. So these three sentences illustrate the three different ways that an objective case pronoun ought to be used: as the direct object of the verb, the indirect object of the verb, or the object of a preposition. The third and final pronoun case to be aware of is the possessive case. The possessive case is used when a pronoun shows possession or ownership. And there are two different ways that possessive case pronouns can be used. First, here's the list of possessive case pronouns that you need to be aware of. My, mine, your, yours, his, her, hers, its, our, ours, their, and theirs. Notice, by the way, in looking at the words on this list, although a number of them end in the letter S, none of them ever contain an apostrophe. Many students make a mistake of putting an apostrophe before the S when using some of these possessive pronouns. For example, many students put an apostrophe S into the word its. They're confusing it with the contraction its, which means it is. When you use its to mean it is, then it's correct to put in an apostrophe S. But when its is being used as a possessive pronoun, no apostrophe should be used. I mentioned that there are two ways that possessive case pronouns can be used. Here are the two ways. The first way is to use the possessive case pronoun like an adjective to modify a noun. When this is being done, the possessive case pronoun comes before the noun and acts very much as an adjective. The possessive pronouns which are used in this way as adjectives are my, your, his, her, its, our, and their. Here's a sentence that illustrates this use of a possessive case pronoun. Dr. Chen took his car to the garage for a tune-up. Here we have the possessive pronoun his, and it comes just before the noun car. So it explains exactly whose car was being taken to the garage. In other words, it shows possession or ownership of the car by Dr. Chen. His is the pronoun that refers back to Dr. Chen, and it's a possessive pronoun because it shows Dr. Chen's possession or ownership of the car. And in this case, his is being used very much as an adjective. It gives a little more information about the car. What kind of car? Whose car? It was his car, Dr. Chen's car. So his, in this case, is a possessive pronoun being used as an adjective to modify the noun car. Now, by contrast, some possessive pronouns stand alone and do not modify nouns. For this purpose, the possessive pronouns that which can work in this way are as follows. Mine, yours, his, hers, ours, and theirs. Here's an example. The mechanic asked Dr. Chen if the violin in the back seat was his. Now here we see the possessive pronoun his being used, but notice that it isn't followed by a noun. In some cases, possessive pronouns act as adjectives modifying nouns. In other cases, they stand alone. They don't modify nouns, but instead almost act like nouns themselves. That's what's happening in this sentence. The pronoun his refers back to Dr. Chen. In effect, it means Dr. Chen's or Dr. Chen's violin, but it doesn't precede a noun. Instead, it stands alone. And that illustrates the other way in which possessive case pronouns can be used. So, once again, these are the three cases for all pronouns: subjective case, objective case, and possessive case. It's important to recognize the difference among the three and to know when to use each of these cases depending on how the pronoun is being used in the particular sentence. In your study guide, we've provided an exercise which will enable you to test your understanding of this concept of pronoun case. Try your hand at the questions, and then let's look at the answers together. Now, in these sentences, one or more personal pronouns have been omitted, and your job is to choose from among the alternatives which is the correct personal pronoun to insert to complete the sentence correctly. Of course, in order to answer that, you'll need to understand how the pronoun is being used in the sentence, whether it's being used in a way that calls for a subjective case pronoun, an objective case pronoun, or a possessive case pronoun. Let's take a look at the first example. When Audrey's car broke down, Carlos lent her or she another. Now, the personal pronoun in this case is being used in what fashion? What role is it playing in the sentence? Is it the subject of the verb, for example? No, Carlos is the subject of the verb lent. Instead, the personal pronoun that's missing here is an indirect object. Carlos lent what? He lent another, meaning another car. So another is the direct object of the verb lent. The pronoun that would come in between the verb and the direct object would be serving as an indirect object. It would tell to whom Carlos lent another, meaning another car. And remember that a word that's inserted in that place in the sentence and tells to whom or for whom the action of the verb is being done would be an indirect object. Well, a pronoun that's being used as an indirect object should be in the objective case. And as we've seen, her is the objective case pronoun to refer to a female, a single female individual. So the sentence should correctly read, when Audrey's car broke down, Carlos lent her another. Here's our second sentence. A group tour is not a good vacation choice for us or we, because us or we prefer traveling independently. Here we have two missing pronouns, and in both cases we have the same two pronouns to choose from, us or we. Well, the correct pronoun in each of these instances will be different, because the purpose to which the pronoun is being put is different in each case. The first pronoun is the object of a preposition. The preposition is for. We have a little prepositional phrase beginning with for and followed by the pronoun. And remember that a pronoun which is the object of a preposition should be in the objective case. Which pronoun is in the objective case, us or we? The answer is us. So the first choice for this sentence should be us. Now the second pronoun is being used as the subject of a verb, the verb prefer. The second clause here tells what we prefer doing, and since we is the subject, it needs to be in the subjective case, and we would be correct. So the sentence should read, a group tour is not a good vacation choice for us because we prefer traveling independently. Next sentence, is this bicycle you or yours? Well, what kind of pronoun is missing here? Is it a subjective case pronoun, an objective case pronoun, or a possessive case pronoun? Well, what's missing in this sentence is a possessive case pronoun. We need a pronoun that will refer back to or explain who or what owns the bicycle, because that's what the sentence is getting at. The antecedent would be you, the person hearing the sentence, because that's who is referred to by either you or yours. Since we need a possessive case pronoun, yours would be correct. We saw earlier that the pronoun you can be used either as a subjective or objective case pronoun, but yours needs to be used in this context because we need a possessive case pronoun. So the sentence should read, is this bicycle yours? Next example. By a unanimous vote, the judges decided that the best debater on the team was he or him. Well, remember that one of the ways that a subjective case pronoun is used is when the pronoun is being used as a subject complement. In other words, after a verb of being, a noun or pronoun which follows the verb of being and refers back to the subject of the verb would be a subject complement. And in this case, the pronoun he or him is being used in just that way. We have the verb of being, was, and what follows it refers back to debater. It explains more or gives more information about who the best debater was. It was he. Since it's being used as a subject complement, the pronoun should be in the subjective case, and therefore he is correct rather than him, which would be in the objective case. Last sentence. Mr. and Mrs. Nkrumah have invited I or me to stay for 2 weeks in their or theirs home in Kenya. Here we have two pronouns to fill in. The first pronoun should be in the objective case because it is being used as the direct object of the verb invited or have invited. The subject of that verb is Mr. and Mrs. Nkrumah. Have invited is the action, and receiving the action of that verb is me, the direct object. We want the objective case, and therefore the objective case me is correct rather than the subjective case I. What about the second pronoun? To stay for 2 weeks in their or theirs home in Kenya. Well, both their and theirs are possessive case pronouns, and we can see from the context here that a possessive case pronoun is what is wanted. We want the possessive case pronoun which can work as an adjective modifying the noun home, because we see the noun home follows the pronoun, and therefore we want the pronoun to describe or define the ownership or possession of that noun. And the correct pronoun to serve as an adjective in the possessive case would be there, without the letter S at the end. So the correct sentence would finally read, Mr. and Mrs. Nkrumah have invited me to stay for 2 weeks in their home in Kenya. Theirs would be a correct choice if we were choosing a possessive pronoun to stand alone without having a noun following it. That's not the case here, which is why we want to use their rather than theirs. View portions of this program again if you need a brief refresher. I hope you did find this program helpful, and I'll look forward to speaking with you about other English topics on other programs in this series. Thanks for watching.